welcome, Bhagya.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, Confederation of Indian Micro, Small and Medium Entrepreneurs Global Council for the Promotion of International Trade is proud to host world's biggest over exhibition come conference called Global Women Brand India. Okay, so now you're part of Brand India. So where we are conducting series of women interviews for women entrepreneurs. Okay, so as of now we have touched almost 50 plus interviews, and we are planning to continue this series of interviews for 500 plus or maybe 1,000 plus women. Okay,
awesome.
So welcome here, Bhagya, for this.
Thank you so much, Sunita,
to be in this platform. And I was just going through your profile. I just want to know, what made you to start your own entrepreneur or your venture?
As I told you, I had some brief spells of working in different industry, mainly in the service industry, in different capacities, and mainly the hotel industry. And I also have a diploma in fashion designing, which I got from Birla Institute of Liberal Arts and Management Sciences. That was way back, many years back in Calcutta. Okay. So I always had this keen interest to, you know, experiment with clothes and different fabrics and designs and all that. So that was why I started Vedanshi. Vedanshi is my own company wherein I do clothes. I design clothes.
Okay.
And the other one, the Annapurneshwari Food and Services Private Limited, that company was bought by my husband. Basically, that was entirely his idea. But that was only dealing with the basic idli dosa batter. And when he bought the business, I was very keen to join that as well, because by nature, I'm into healthy eating. And I thought that this is, I believe in that saying that you are what you eat. So if you eat healthy food, I think the current new age diseases are all related to, that kind of food habits that we have adopted from the West and from many other countries. And we have, lost touch with our own traditional food. So keeping that in mind, also trying to keep it, it has to be somewhat trendy for others to be able to have it also. So keeping that in mind, I have introduced a lot of new items in the existing category of batters. So we have introduced 7 new batters, and also falafel and tahini and hummus from international cuisine.
Okay.
All these are completely preservative free, and they are free of pesticides and natural products. And these are all, complying with healthy eating. So, okay. Which is why I'm very interested in both the businesses.
Okay. So do you have your own manufacturing plant or?
Yes.
Just share the space with somebody else.
No, for the food processing unit, we have our own factory in Hebbal, and we have a team of production team which produces the whole thing, and then we have it packed, stored, and delivery also is done by us. Entire thing is done by us under one roof, and the fabrics, I outsource all the work.
Okay. And,
I deliver the finished product. I design, I procure the clothes. The fabrics, I have it designed, have it stitched, and then I have it delivered, courier to the client.
Okay.
For that, I don't have a separate space. I work, operate out of home.
Okay.
But for the other product, we have factory in.
Okay. So, how do you divide your time for both the work? One is
In Vedanshi, yes. In Vedanshi, it's not an everyday basis. It's on when I attend exhibitions and animals. On those days, I'm out doing that. And whenever there are orders, I do it in the second part of the day, because all the entire first half of the day goes in the food production.
Okay.
So that is an everyday thing. So we are busy in that on an everyday basis. And typically in the first half, that gets over.
Okay.
And my other thing starts.
Okay.
Since I told you, both me and my husband handle that food business together.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm not present, he's able to handle that.
Okay.
So, when I'm doing the exhibitions, the whole day goes off. That.
Okay. So for the food, from where do you procure the materials and all? Because you have to see the standard, quality.
Yes. Yes.
How do you maintain this?
Since I told you, we bought an existing business. It was not started by us. It was an existing business. An elderly man had been running it. Mm-hmm. We bought it ready-made from him. So all the standards, everything that he was following, the rice was procured from Kumbakonam, because the kind of rice that you require, it's a little different from what you get locally.
Mm-hmm.
And the results are not the same.
Mm-hmm.
So we buy rice from there. It comes to the mandi from where we procure in bulk, and dal and the rice, those are our main items.
Mm-hmm.
Everything gets bought from there. So the same brand we use, we don't change it. So quality is assured.
Mm-hmm. So what is the feedback you get from the customers?
People, especially during lockdown, people were really appreciating it, because nobody could go out. We were delivering it to their doorstep, because we had to change a lot of systems. There earlier, our business was only for businesses.
Okay.
No, it was B2B. But now, since lockdown and since I went full time into that business too, we started catering to a lot of B2C clients too.
Okay.
So people were appreciating the fact that we were able to home deliver the products, and within a matter of 5 to 10 minutes, you could have a meal ready. You know, and with all people at home, and you know, a lot of extra meals being cooked, that was really coming handy. And once they use the product, they know it's good, and we have always had repeat customers. So on an every week basis, people buy from us.
So do you supply to the hotels on the catering services, or only you just meet the B2C direct customers?
No. Right now, B2C is got the bigger chunk of the business. But earlier, it was solely B2B, where we supply to all the big catering companies. They used to take to the tune of 500 kgs, 600 kgs per day. And these big catering companies, in turn, they make the food and then supply to all the big firms, IT firms, basically. IT firms are the ones, basically, which gives lunches. They have those lunch things in the offices. So all the companies which provide lunches to their employees, they were our clients. So indirectly, we are connected to the IT company.
So did you face any challenges in terms of investment, or did somebody support you for the investment in starting this venture?
First, God's help was there all along.
Uh-huh.
He's been, at every step, I can see the blessings there. Uh-huh. And apart from that, yes, family support, immense support. And we have loans from the bank, and whatever my husband had saved, he had a long career of 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever he had saved, he had invested that also in the business. The challenges were, it's not a very unique product, so anybody can make better. It's not so unique. In that term, yes, it was a challenge, like to enter the market, which has already been captured by a few other bigger companies.
Okay.
Every corner or every area in Bangalore has its own local batter.
Okay. Yes. That's true. Yeah. That's
so if you're
true,
used to a particular one, it's very difficult to remove a client from there, what they're used to, and then go on to something else altogether to give a try.
Uh-huh.
Is, in that way, also, lockdown has been very good for us, because most of the smaller ones shut down because either they didn't have delivery happening, or then some problems with staffing, what I don't know. So in that way, many people were willing to give us a try. Though even though it's a new brand, they were willing to give us a try. And once the batter is used, then they know what it is. So then it was not so difficult. And entering into the B2C market was initially, yes, very tough. For 2 weeks, we kept trying to enter the apartments and, tried to see whether we can, introduce our batters there.
Mm-hmm.
Success came only after two and a half weeks. And then the same people are ordering from us regularly.
Okay. So do you have any plans to venture outside Karnataka or Bangalore?
We would want to solely concentrate on Bangalore, because Bangalore being so huge, we are hardly tapping just a few areas, Whitefield and Koramangala. These are the only two major areas we are present now in.
Mm-hmm.
And there is huge potential in Bangalore itself. Right now, I would want to do only that, because though it's an easy product to make, it's not that easy.
Okay.
So you need to have experts handling the product to know the texture and the consistency and all that. So unless we have experts at hand, you cannot really open another unit. So, and this unit can churn up to 1,000 kgs a day. So it's got a huge capacity. So with that itself, we can supply to various places and in higher quantities.
So how do you market this product?
We have not
awareness to the people.
Yes. That is where we were slightly lacking. We don't have a social media presence. It's solely through word of mouth. Okay. And the B2B also is entirely word of mouth. Mm-hmm. And in this, in B2C, yes, some clients referred us to their friends. Mm-hmm. Predominantly, I would say word of mouth is what has been helping us so long. Okay. But I do feel that an online presence would also help me better.
Okay. So whom do you support? Your employees are women or male, or you're just balancing the gender equality?
In my Vedanshi venture, yes, many people who make the fabrics and all, they are men. And all the stitching part and the embroidery part and all the nimble work, wherever nimble work is required, mm-hmm. all those are women. And okay. And in Annapurneshwari, the entire production team is women. Okay. We wanted to keep it that way because people have to work in close proximity there. Uh-huh. And we thought, keeping the sensibilities in mind, uh-huh. we thought we should not mix the gender. So it's all women out there. In fact, it was very nice when we began. That is how it was. And we have maintained that throughout. Even mm-hmm. though we have had challenges with women, they have to take care of their family. Sometimes they will not report for work because the child is unwell. All those problems we had to face, but somehow we have overcome that because it's nice having an all-women team who are very mm-hmm. comfortable with one another, and they work. Only the drivers are the delivery persons, only they are men. Okay. The entire team is all women. And during lockdown, when many of their husbands lost their jobs because they're mm-hmm. all daily wage earners, some of them, mm-hmm. and some of them worked in other smaller factories, these women who are semi-literate and semi-skilled, they're the ones who became the bread earners for the family. So okay. we were proud of the fact that, yes, we could do something in our own way to, help them.
Mm-hmm. So how many hours you can keep this barter? Suppose you're told you'll be...
Batter, yes. Mm-hmm. We have a specialized way of storing the batter. As mm-hmm. soon as the production is made, even just when it comes out of the machine, it is sealed, it is measured, sealed and kept in the cold rooms. The cold room is kept at minus 2 degrees centigrade. So okay. it freezes. And uh-huh. after that, it has a long shelf life of 10 days. So nothing happens to the batter. There is no fermentation happening at all, which okay. is why this batter can be kept for a long time. And when we take it out and deliver to our clients also, it is kept in insulated boxes. And that box is also kept in an insulated van. And that's how it's transported. So even if the batter is there outside the refrigerator from morning till evening, nothing happens to it because it's in a semi-solid form. And as soon as it's delivered, the client takes it and puts it in our fridge.
Okay.
Then also there is no fermentation happening. So till the person is ready to use it, it is unfermented. Once they want to use it, then they need to ferment it. Some people don't want fermented batter, then they can use it straight away.
Do you use any preservatives for this or no?
No, it is completely no preservatives, nothing. It doesn't require anything.
Okay.
It doesn't even have salt because many people have to go on low salt and less salt and no salt-free diet completely. So keeping all that in mind, we don't add salt also. So the client has to add, according to their taste, they add the salt also.
Okay.
Oh. It's pesticide-free, chemical-free, and no preservative also.
Okay. So what is your future plans on your business?
I feel this this can go... there is a lot of potential in the sense. I can see now more and more people are conscious about what they eat and okay. they want something healthy. And uh-huh. You can make, the sky's the limit. You have batter in your hand, you can make anything you want. I even made a pizza base with that. So when you put all the toppings for a pizza on that, you can actually not even get the taste of the batter. So the pizza toppings are very strong. So you can make whatever you want with it. Those paniaram we call that uh-huh. thing. Uh-huh. That also you can make idlis and dosas. And in dosas also, there's so many stuffings which you can use instead of the regular potato stuffing. So mm-hmm. the sky is the limit. As long as you can experiment, you can make anything you want with the batter. It can go places. And we have also introduced newly the millet batter, which okay. has an equal proportion of millet in it. So okay. very many people are also understanding the need to introduce millets. But mm-hmm. Some people, if they're not used to it, they are not very happy with the taste of millet as such. That's only true. Millets. So in this, when it's disguised with a little bit of dal and the other regular rice, you can't get the taste of millet separately. So that is our newest addition, and that's been received very well by our clients. So I think this can actually be spread to entire Bangalore. I just need help on that area to spread it to all over the place. all over the city.
So this vata is only for dosa idli you make or some like
vada? We do adais. Yes, we are into adais. Like initially when we bought the company, it was only for dosa idli batter.
Okay.
Then we introduced millet, then we use adai.
Okay.
And we have ragi.
Okay.
And then we'd have two kinds of vada batters.
Okay.
And then we have this falafel mix, which is a ready mix. All you need to do is just make ball out of it and fry it. Two dips we have along with this. So if people want, they can order the dips also. That's one is called hummus and the other is called tahini. And hummus is made with chickpeas. That is chola, we call it, you know.
Okay. Chola bhatura type. Yeah.
Yes, the chola. Huh. And tahini is made with sesame seeds. So
okay.
these are very, very healthy. And we also I've introduced two new powders. One is the sambar powder and the other one is a sesame chutney powder, which again is very, very healthy. And in case, especially for vegetarians and all that, when, you know, calcium is a big problem in a natural diet, sesame seeds is full of calcium. So, you know, it's a very tasty version of having something healthy. So these two powders we have introduced because we realize that many people don't know very authentic sambar, and I belong to Tamil Nadu, so we make very good sambar.
Yeah,
so I
taste once.
It's kind of authentic sambar is what from Tamil Nadu is what I would like to think. So based on the recipes that has been handed down to us from my mother and grandmother and all that, we have introduced the two powders also. So these powders have also been received very well by our clients.
So this powders and the masalas, which you don't know, it has been taken from your mother or family, or somebody is doing R&D on this?
No, there is no R&D done on it. We just, I know what products go into it, what ingredients go into it. And based on that, I do the calorific value.
Okay.
And the recipes have been handed down by generations. I follow the same recipe.
Mm-hmm.
And it is all done by us, by our women in our facility. So it's all freshly made.
Okay.
Because they're a little sensitive to temperature changes. So it has to be maintained at a reasonably cool temperature for it to remain fresh.
Mm-hmm.
So we make small batches. And once that is over, only then the next batch is made. So we don't store it for too long to retain the freshness.
So you take the order and then make the batter, or you just make it and then you sell it? Yeah,
that is not very easily, you have to guesstimate that. You have to guess how many orders will come in. So typically we have on Mondays, we post for Wednesday deliveries, and we post on Thursday for Saturday deliveries. So these 2 days, we try and give to about 10 apartments.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Between the 2 days, we cater to about 9 to 10 apartments.
Okay.
So to some extent, we know, yes, this is the number of orders. They already order it. It's a pre-ordered thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we just do a few extra packets because we know that some people forget. Typically, some people will forget to order and then they might want to buy.
Mm-hmm.
So then they're also catered to.
Okay. Have you experienced any challenges in your business so far? And how did you overcome?
Yes.
Just a bit challenges.
Yes, challenges come in the way, mainly it is there in the B2B clients, where on paper they say it's a 45-day payment, but anytime between 2 to 3 months they will make for payment. And you cannot say anything to them, and they form the backbone of your business, so you cannot be harsh with them, you can't say anything. And we have to take loans to, till we get those payments. So there we have faced a lot of hurdles. And B2C, it's much easier. The payment happens immediately.
Okay.
But the volume is not that high.
Okay.
So if I have to really make this business absolute success, I have to depend on the B2C clients only, whereby I'll have to know more people and, my visibility has to increase. Then this business can really go places.
Okay, fine. Okay. So since your joint CMSME, it's almost 1+ years of a journey. So what do you feel about CMSME? What is your takeaways?
I actually, when I joined it, a very good friend of mine introduced me to CMSME. And when I joined it, I was actually absolutely clueless. I didn't know what I was supposed to be doing. And she said, initially think of it as a great learning platform.
Uh-huh.
And I thought I knew many things about my business. What more do I need to learn and all that? And when I joined it, that was last year. And luckily, we went through a whole 1-month long course program in which we learned every single thing. We saw where all we had flawed, where we made the mistakes, because this doesn't come naturally to us. My entire family, everybody, they're all professionals. So I am the only one who's into business. And same way for my husband also, he has a rich experience of 30 years in corporate world. And then he also went into that. So both of us are new to businesses. Huh. So it has been very challenging. And all the mistakes that we made were pointed out to us during this course that we attended. And it's been a huge learning for me. No, I'm so happy that I've associated myself with CIMSME. And yes, I have not been able to devote so much time because I'm caught between the two businesses. As much as I want to, I'm not able to devote that much time. And also my second constraint is I don't speak the local language, which is why I feel that, if I go a little to interior, districts, language could be a constraint. So I think a lot could be done. And with great guidance, I think we can definitely achieve it. Because this is a great platform for anybody. And the more and more number of people come to know about it, the more the benefit will be. And I've also been always interested in doing something for the society.
Oh, very nice.
Towards that, whatever I want to do, I think CIMSME can be a great help in this regard also. So to take it to a larger audience, I think it will be very helpful.
Okay. So
the way that I got benefited by attending these courses, I think there's a whole lot of people who will also benefit from this.
Okay. So if given a chance to contribute something in CIMSME, so what do you feel the best you can give to CIMSME?
Yes, as I said, I can bring more and more people into the fold. Once I really know how to go about this, I'm still, unfortunately, I lost my aunt. So I'm not even in Bangalore right now. I'm in Kolkata.
Okay.
So I'll be coming back in a month or so. And I wish to completely devote few hours of my time every week, definitely to increasing the increasing the number of people who can be benefited by CIMSME.
So what is the message you want to give for the upcoming entrepreneurs?
Yes. At least I will tell them not to make the mistakes that I made.
What is the mistake that we made, Bhagya?
So to scale up too soon. Don't scale up too soon. Whatever product, you create the product, believe in it completely. Be completely convinced about it. Only when you are convinced about something yourself, 100%, can you convince others.
Yes.
And it's very difficult to, move away a person from people are generally loyal to a certain brand. So if you want that person to move, your brand has to be, your product has to be that good. And if you believe in your product, only then you others will believe in it. So that's point number one. That's what I would like to say. And it's your use your money very wisely, because it's your hard-earned money or your family's hard-earned money. So don't squander it, because every entrepreneur thinks that it's very easy to make money. So just open a business and sit there and that's it. You'll be making profits and more profits. It's not that simple. And yes, for all legal work, take the best help that you can afford, because legally, you can get into a lot of trouble if you're not completely compliant. So take all the legal help that you require.
But did you face any challenges in this legal compliance in your factory?
I did, because as I told you, we bought this business from another gentleman and we had spent a huge amount of money through our lawyers and got all the papers intact, everything, we got everything, and most of the payment was also made and towards only the last installment was left and then this, I still call him uncle even though he did all this, this uncle kind of went around and and changed and said he's not willing to sell the business anymore. We already paid the money. We have left everything there and we came here, and now he's saying, no, I'm not interested in selling the business. So he said he was even returned the money back. But your whole, this thing, you're thinking of doing something, you have left your job and you've come and settled here. And then if somebody says, no, I don't, I've changed my mind, that's a very wrong thing to do. And even though we had all the papers, everything was there, our lawyers themselves suggested that don't go to the court, because if you go to the court, you know how it is. It will take typically very long. Neither will he benefit nor will you benefit. So you do an out-of-court settlement.
Okay.
So which is why I'm keeping on saying that it's very important to get to the right lawyers, get your papers right, so that you're strong there.
Yeah.
You know, and it's very important to do that. And it's your business. Go all out. Take help from anywhere you want. You know, a lot of people are very helpful, and take the help from everybody and give your 100% to the business.
That's really lovely. Sure, I loved it. Yeah.
But I'm sure success is there.
Yes, 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 yes. Yeah, that's it, Bhagya. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Sunita.
Your time. It was for this.
Wonderful talking to you. Thank you for giving me your time.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Santoshi, for giving me this opportunity. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.